Hello, this is State Representative Brad Stevens. I want to welcome you to my special COVID-19 live teletown hall meeting. This morning, I'm coming to you from my legislative office to discuss the COVID-19 virus, the governor's executive order to stay home in order to promote social distancing, and to answer questions that you may have about the virus and its impacts on state government. I'm pleased to be joined by two local subject matter experts today who will be joining in a few minutes. They're practicing social distancing and will be joining us remotely. They're Dr. John Allegretti, who's a specialist in emergency medicine with Advocate Lutheran General Hospital, and Dr. Matthew Jordan. Dr. Jordan specializes in emergency medicine at Resurrection Medical Center. I'm greatly appreciative that they are taking their time out of their extraordinary busy schedules during this pandemic. During this call, I'll be sharing some very important information. And if you have any questions about this information, please contact my office. The office email is repstevens, R-E-P-S-T-E-P-H-E-N-S, at ilhousegop.org. And my office phone number is 773-444-0611. I also encourage you to sign up for email updates from my website by going to repstevens.com. Again, that's Stevens with a PH. For those that did not get the information the first time, the office email again is repstevens at ilhousegop.org, and my phone number is 773-444-0611. And I encourage you to sign up for email updates at repstevens.com. The website additionally has COVID-19 resource links that provide information on the virus, how to limit the spread, and where to go if you or your family is in need during this time. I'll be sharing that information again shortly. I encourage you to get a pen and paper if you want to write it down. COVID-19, or the coronavirus, is getting more serious by the day. The latest figures show that we have over 1,000 cases in Illinois. 296 new cases were just announced yesterday, and the governor is expecting more to be announced today. We're going to be taking your questions in about 10 minutes. If you have a question that you would like to ask me or one of our experts, please press *3 and you will be put into a queue to ask a question. For those of us just joining us, again, this is State Representative Brad Stevens, and I welcome you to this special COVID-19 live teletown hall meeting. This morning, I'm coming from the legislative office to discuss COVID-19 virus, the governor's executive order to stay at home in order to promote social distancing and to answer your questions about the virus and its impacts on state government. We have two local subject matter experts that will be joining in a few minutes that are practicing social distancing. They'll be calling in remotely. Dr. John Allegretti, who's a specialist in emergency medicine at Advocate Lutheran General Hospital, and Dr. Matthew Jordan, who specializes in emergency medicine at Resurrection Medical Center. I greatly appreciate them taking their time out of their extraordinary busy schedules during this pandemic. We'll also be sharing some important information. If you have any questions about this information, you can contact my office. Again, Rep Stevens at ilhousegop.org, and the phone number is 773-444-0611, and please sign up for any email updates at repstevens.com. That's Stevens with a PH. Okay, so again, the coronavirus is getting more serious by the day. The latest figures show we have over 1,000 cases in Illinois, 296 announced just yesterday, and the governor is expecting more cases to be announced today. We're going to be taking questions. If you have a question that you would like to ask me or one of the experts, please press *3 and you'll be put into a queue to ask a question. Here's where we are today. The latest figures that show, again, over 1,000 cases in Illinois, 296 announced yesterday. On Saturday, Governor Pritzker put in a stay-at-home order. The goal of this order is to promote social distancing. Nobody likes that this has to be done, but I do believe it's necessary to flatten the curve. I am sure that almost everyone is familiar with the stay-at-home order, or at least some degree. but I want to clarify some unfortunate rumors. You'll still be able to leave your house to go to the grocery store to get food. You'll still be able to visit a pharmacy, go to a medical office or a hospital, or to gas up your car at a gas station. You'll still be able to go running or hiking or walk a dog. There is absolutely no need to rush out to the grocery store or the gas station today or tomorrow and every day thereafter. Those will be available to you. You can still pick up dinner at your local restaurant, pick up your prescriptions, or just spend time with your family. Again, if you have any questions on the stay-at-home order or wondering if you or your business are considered essential, please contact my office at RepStevens@ILHOUSEGOP.org or my office phone at 773-444-0611. The federal government has delayed tax returns until July 15th. That is both for payment and filing of the tax return, but Illinois has not done so just yet. So at this point, Illinois tax returns are still due on April 15th. That was actually brought up in yesterday's governor's press conference. There was a specific question, and he said that they are looking into that and would get back. He's concerned about cash flow for the state. The governor's office is working to extend that again, but due to the budget situation, he's not committing to that just yet. We are advocating to extend that deadline. Additionally, this has hit the economy, especially the local economy, tourism, hotels, air traffic has all come to a screaming halt. I'm working to help those that have been impacted. The governor will be introducing a revamped unemployment insurance benefit claims website today. This should help you get better, faster, and more streamlined access to benefits if you're unemployed because of this pandemic. I was told that the site will be going live today. If you're experiencing problems applying, please contact my office and we can direct you where to go. I'm also working on getting tax extension for our hotel and tourism industry, similar to the one that JB has given to bars and restaurants. This will keep people employed. Our subject matter experts are on the line and ready to join us. Remember, if you'd like to ask a question, press *3. After I introduce them, we'll be opening the line for your questions. Dr. Matthew Jordan specializes in emergency medicine at Resurrection Medical Center. The first question I have is, Dr. Jordan, can you explain what bending the curve is and how the stay-at-home order accomplishes that?
Certainly. So with the bending of the curve, we're looking at trying to stop the spike of cases that will be seen at the hospital or in healthcare facilities. If we do not social distance or do not spread the immediate curve, we will have a large spike and an overwhelm of the healthcare system almost immediately. So what the social distancing does is decrease the number of cases that we all get at once. We'll probably still have close to number of the same number of people that are infected just over a longer period of time, and will help prevent overwhelming at the healthcare facilities. That's mainly what we're doing by social distancing with this current premise, which I think is a good thing.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Jordan. I mean, can you explain where we're at on the curve right now? I would think that this is trending upward.
So right now we are seeing a large spike in number of cases that are presenting to the hospital, specifically those that are ill and needing care and being hospitalized, not so much the walking well. The social distancing will take anywhere from, 7 to 14 days to really show its benefits. We are not seeing that yet because of, again, those people that are now walking and had infection prior to that. And so our hope is that within the next couple of days, we start seeing the fruit of our, labor by having the social distancing and a decrease or a flattening of the curve at that time.
Thank you, Dr. Jordan. Also with us is Dr. John Allegretti, who is an attending physician in the Department of Emergency Medicine at Advocate Lutheran General Hospital. He's been there since 2001. He also currently serves as a vice chair of emergency services, as well as quality director at Advocate Lutheran General Hospital. Dr. Allegretti, can you help explain what the symptoms of COVID-19 are?
Yeah, as probably many of you know, the symptoms of COVID-19 mainly is a constellation of symptoms which include fever, dry persistent cough, malaise or body aches. Those tend to be the most prominent symptoms with COVID-19. There is a small subset of patients who have some gastrointestinal symptoms. A very small percentage will have sore throat. That doesn't seem to be as prevalent with COVID-19. But the main symptoms will be fever, dry cough, and general malaise or body aches.
And then how does this differ from a common cold and the flu? I mean, can you explain that?
So one of the difficulties for us healthcare providers is that there's much overlap in the symptoms between COVID-19 and influenza and even the common cold, in that you can have cough in all three, you can have fever in all three. There is some difference in sort of the abruptness of the symptoms. Normally, influenza will hit you very quickly. Usually within a day, you spike very high fevers and almost all your symptoms sort of reach their maximum quickly. COVID-19 seems to take a little bit more time to reach that maximum in symptoms. But to be honest, as a healthcare provider, it's very difficult for us to just determine based on that. In essence, if you're coming to us currently with fever, cough, body aches, things of that sort, COVID-19 is definitely on our differential.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Allegretti. Now we're going to open it up for questions from the public. Again, if you'd like to ask a question, press *3 at any time, and I will turn it over to David, who is helping screen these calls.
Our first question is from Carmen, who has a question about flying and air travel. Carmen, you are on the line.
Oh, hi there. I have a question. So my daughter is in the process of flying back to Chicago from Australia. And when she landed in LA, she told me that there was somebody on her flight who was really sick and coughing a lot. And I know that obviously, one of the things that we don't want to do right now is to be traveling. But I'm just wondering, should we tell somebody about that, or do we just not? Not sure what the protocol is.
Dr. Allegretti, will you answer that one, please?
Yeah, sure. I wonder if I could clarify the question. Are you asking if we should tell somebody if there was someone who was coughing on the plane, or kind of what people should do as it relates to plane travel in general?
Dr. Allegretti, I'm sorry, she fell off the line.
That's okay. I'll answer it both ways then. So one of the things I think people need to understand as it relates to COVID-19 and its spread is it's spread via large respiratory droplets, which means it doesn't stay in the air very long. It tends to actually fall to the ground or to surfaces quite quickly. And that's why it's so essential that people perform frequent hand hygiene, because you're much more likely to actually introduce the virus into your system by touching a surface that someone who potentially was infected coughed on, and you then introduce that the virus from the surface you touch to your mouth, to your nose, or your eyes. And so one of the main ways that you can prevent that is by performing frequent hand hygiene. In terms of plane travel, one of the things that puts you at most risk for potential aerosolized exposure would be extremely close contact. Usually we'll say within 6 feet of somebody. Just the fact that someone may have been coughing on your plane doesn't necessarily mean you're at higher risk unless you were extremely in close proximity to them. And like I said earlier, many of the patients who have those symptoms often may actually just have the common cold or influenza.
Thank you, doctor.
Questions about the mail. So I'm going to bring on David, who has a question about opening up mail. David, you're live and on the line.
That was my question. Are there any guidelines for opening mail and packages that come into your home?
Dr. Jordan?
I don't think there are specific guidelines from the standpoint of what Dr. Allegretti had said. Most of the time, this virus is not so hardy that it stays viable that long on inanimate objects. There are certain ones where it's more viable, but from the standpoint of you going through your mail, if you'd like to wash your hands and make sure that after you touch the stuff, that would probably be your best bet. It's not like you open the mail and you inhale that you'll be getting the virus. For the most part, if it's going to be something that's transferred to you, like from a doorknob or from your mail or some other inanimate object, if you're concerned, good hand hygiene is probably your best bet. And so after you've done your mail, wash your hands, don't touch your face or your eyes, is your best bet. But there's no specific protocol, and I don't think mail opening is a high-risk exposure where you're going to be too terribly, you know, concerned about getting it from mail opening.
Thank you.
All right, we have another question from Christine. Christine has parents who she's concerned about. Christine, you are live and on the line.
Good morning.
Morning.
So my question is, my parents are 87, 86 years old. They have the usual health issues of people their ages. Now, if they were to start experiencing symptoms of coronavirus, and let's say they contacted their doctors and their doctor said, take them to the ER, which would be Res on Talcott, will they automatically be tested for coronavirus?
Dr. Jordan, will you answer that one, please?
The answer is no. At this point, currently the CDC is testing only those that are meeting certain criteria from hospitalization standpoint. They're trying to limit the number of people that get tested because of lack of testing materials that we have right now and just identify those that truly meet it. So we meet, or we say COVID people with infection are mild, moderate, severe, critical. The vast majority of people that get COVID will be in the mild or moderate, so that's over 80%. A very few percentage of them will be in the severe and critical, and that's where current recommendations are that they get tested if you're going to be hospitalized. At this point, with the number of cases and the spiking of the virus itself, I'm under the assumption that most people with cough and cold should be considered to have COVID until proven otherwise, and unless they're symptomatic, they probably would be discharged home with the notion, continue to watch your symptoms, watch how you're feeling, and use common sense, meaning if you start getting terribly short of breath, you become very symptomatic in a sense of how bad you feel, certainly go to the hospital. But having a mild infection itself, we probably wouldn't do much with, meaning the treatment's just supportive care and treating your fever, treating how you feel. And until you get more short of breath, most of the time, people will get better without any treatment and just improve.
Thank you.
We do have email questions coming in, and there are a lot of questions asking about the process for taking in COVID patients at the hospital and the potential for the number of cases to come in. Would you guys be willing to answer some questions about that, or in general speak about the process?
Yes, this is Dr. Allegretti. I'd be happy to address
that. Why won't they be tested then? He said no.
In terms of how we're approaching it currently is that in our emergency department, we've actually separated the waiting area into potential COVID patients versus non-COVID patients, so there's not commingling up front, so that if you're coming to the emergency department because of a leg injury, you will be separated so that there is less chance of exposure when in the emergency department. We've dedicated a separate area of the treatment area of the emergency department for COVID, potential COVID patients, so that staff who is taking care of these patients can be focused on them, that those patients are in essence cohorted into one area, which limits then commingling with other patients. And then on the hospital side, we've dedicated full unit of our hospital solely to the treatment of COVID-related patients in an attempt to, A, maximize our bed space for these patients, but more importantly, make sure that these patients are in one area of the hospital so it is less likely that there is commingling with non-affected patients.
Thank you.
I echo the same thing at our facility. We're doing pretty much the same thing with trying to put those patients that have COVID together and keep those that aren't with those symptoms in a separate area, both in the emergency room and upstairs.
Okay, and I'd like to add, there's a website, Illinois COVID-19. It's ilcovid19info.com. And then again, you can always go to my website, repstevens.com. We, on a daily basis, are reposting all of the information that we're getting from the governor after his press conference. That includes CDC, Department of Public Health, all that information that we have available to us, we're reposting so it's available to the general public. So go ahead, David. I'm sorry.
Okay, the next question that we have is from Mary Ann. Mary Ann's asking about what medicines you should be taking if you're experiencing symptoms. Mary Ann, you're live. What is your question?
My question is, are ibuprofen or other NSAIDs safe for relief of symptoms?
Dr. Allegretti, please.
Based on the most recent World Health Organization recommendation, they are not restricting NSAID use with COVID-19. The one caveat to that I would say is if you're simply using the anti-inflammatory purely for fever control, I would actually just recommend you start with acetaminophen, because if you get benefit from that, as everyone knows, we're learning more and more about this virus on a daily basis, and as more information becomes available, recommendations may change. There is a physiological component where possibly NSAIDs could affect the ability of the virus to get into our pulmonary system. That's where the theoretical concern is about NSAID use during a COVID-19 illness. But currently, the World Health Organization has not restricted its use. I would just say that if you just have a fever and you just want to try something to kind of control the fever, I would probably start with acetaminophen, which is just the generic, you know, form of Tylenol.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right, I have another question that came in online from Sergio, and he is asking about what is categorized as an essential worker and an essential business, and he's specifically asking about construction and how the governor decided who was essential and who wasn't.
I'll answer that one. David, the governor has basically said for those that need to go about their regular business and go to work, that this would probably fall into that. So he's allowed to go to work until the job shuts down. And that's just the general understanding that construction is allowed to continue.
All right, thank you. We have another question from Peggy, who is asking about Meals on Wheels. Peggy, you are on the line. If you have
yes.
a question, please.
Are they still delivering meals?
Yes.
Hello.
Peggy, yes, they are. They are still delivering them. If you have any issues with that, please call my office.
What do I do? Just leave my door open? I'm here all by myself, and I'm on oxygen. I don't know what to do, and I have no one to come to help me. Do I just leave my...
What I'll do, Peggy... Oh, we lost her. She disconnected there. We're going to try to get Peggy's number back and give her a call. And make sure that she gets her meal. But, yes, Meals on Wheels is still operating, and they're practicing social distancing as well. I believe they'll leave the meal at the door and either ring the bell or knock on the door to let the homeowner know that they're there.
And Doctors Jordan and Allegretti, what are the, for general, just dropping off food, what are the social distancing rules that we should be using?
Basically the same as what we were talking about before. I mean, we don't want to have intimate contact or try and stay as much as 6 feet away. And if there is like a person that's symptomatic, you certainly try and avoid touching your face or your eyes, and you want to wash your hands and avoid intimate exposure with that person.
Okay, thank you.
We have another online question about real estate companies. If a person, their wife works for is a realtor, and he wants to know about whether or not it's safe to show homes and what precautions should be made.
I'll answer that one. I think that's basically going to be a personal decision on whether or not that his wife is feeling comfortable to do that. I don't know that is specifically spelled out in the governor's order, whether or not realtors can still show properties. But they always run the risk of you know, contracting this should the person be infected. So that's got to be a personal decision. And I have to leave that up to them. We can double check that and see if that is covered, but I don't believe it's covered in the executive order.
Mike is on the line, and Mike has a question about how the quarantine should work in his specific situation. And this one's for the doctor. Mike, you're live and on the line.
Hi, I had a question, which I probably know the answer to just by common sense. I work in a grocery store. Last Monday, I came down with a lot of fatigue. I went to the doctor. They gave me a test for the flu. It was negative. They basically told me because of my previous health conditions, they wanted me quarantined and also to see if something else showed up later. I'm on day 7. My employer told me I will get paid for the time off. I go to the doctor tomorrow for another flu test to see if it's positive or negative. Based on that, they want to send me back to work. But I've had cancer and heart disease, and my fear is I work with hundreds of people because of a grocery store in a panic mode and people coughing everywhere. Is it wise for me to just stay home? Since I'm such high risk and I don't want to spread it, I'm doing fine on home quarantine. I'm still not feeling 100%, so something is going on. I know the answer is to stay home. It's just, will my doctor tomorrow keep me off work if I ask him to?
Dr. Jordan.
I can't speak for what your doctor is going to do, but most of the recommendations are that if you remain symptomatic, that you stay self-quarantined until your symptoms resolve. From the standpoint of working, once you get fully back to normal health, again, that's a choice you have to make about your financial situation and such. But if you are, you know, healthy or feeling better, you certainly can work and use, again, the sort of hand hygiene and try to use protecting yourself and not, you know, touching things and then touching your face and touching your eyes is your best bet. But I'm hoping that if you tell your doctor that you're not feeling well, that he will continue to self-monitor the symptoms. They say that this lasts anywhere from up to 2 to 14 days is what the ballpark figures, and you're only halfway through is what it sounds like.
Thank you.
Our next question is from Janelle, and Janelle is just wondering about our local hospitals, how they're doing on PPE, and she's also asking about their drive-through testing that you're offering.
This is Janelle, and that is my questions. I know there was drive-through testing at Lutheran General a few days ago, and I've been told it's been discontinued. Is that going to be reinstated? And number two is, how are both hospitals doing on PPE?
This is Dr. Ellegrad. I can address the question as it relates to the drive-through testing. You're correct. Drive-through testing has been suspended. That is mainly due to, as Dr. Jordan referred to earlier in the call, the limited number of tests available. So we are needing to follow the CDC guidelines in terms of who we are testing so that we make sure we have enough tests to test those who are most ill. Could drive-up testing at some point start up again? It could, but I cannot predict that at this time. In terms of how our hospital is doing as it relates to PPE, we're following the CDC guidelines. We are being very conscientious, though, of our PPE use, understanding that we still probably have at least weeks of this to deal with, and that if we aren't conscientious of utilizing our PPE supply, we could stress it significantly. But as of now, we're able to follow the CDC guidelines to a T, but we are being very conscientious of how we use our PPE, making sure the right person is using the appropriate PPE at the right time.
Thank you.
Carmen is also on the line, and Carmen has a question about how long the virus lasts on objects and how long it stays in the air for. Carmen.
Hello. Yes, so this is Carmen. I have two questions. One is, how long does it last, like in your home or on inanimate objects? And two, I want to know, why is it we don't have companies here that will manufacture the testing for us as opposed to waiting for the federal government?
This is Dr. Allegretti. I can adjust the first part in terms of how long does it last. And data is ever-changing as it relates to that question, but there was some study recently produced from the New England Journal of Medicine in the past week that stated that the virus can still live on, especially metal and plastic, for up to 4 hours. It seems to have a shorter span on cardboard. That was more like an hour. So in terms of what we were talking about, your risk of touching something and then bringing that to your mouth, your nose, that gives you kind of a rough idea. Just because it's still on a surface doesn't mean it's as virulent as it is when it first drops onto the surface. In terms of how long it lives in the air, like I said, they tend to be in large respiratory droplets, so it tends to fall to the ground actually fairly quickly. The one caveat to that, and it's something that us healthcare providers are aware of, if someone is using a nebulizer, or in our case, we're going to intubate them, the virus can actually stay in the air longer, close to an hour. So one thing I would say to folks at home, if you have a choice between using your meter dose inhaler versus your nebulizer, you may want to try to use your inhaler, because that does not aerosolize the virus as much as using a nebulizer. If you only have a nebulizer, you use your nebulizer, but I just want folks to kind of understand that.
Our next question is from Christina, has a question about protections on job.
Hi, yes, thank you. I actually have two questions. So my husband is a plumber, and he's going into people's homes, and we obviously don't know if someone is sick in the home when he's going into them. Is there anything that we could be doing so he can protect himself other than hand washing? Is there any evidence of this, you know, being in the water or on like surfaces that he may be touching? And then the second question is regarding testing. We all know that testing is super important. Unfortunately, we just don't have enough of them. Is there any anticipation of when we will be getting more tests?
Oh, I can answer the first question with, you know, it's more along the lines of what Dr. Allegretti had said with, again, just watching what you touch and then watching what you touch your face with. So if there's some concern about an area where there's high likely that this person coughed or was in that area and that person was infected, you'd want to be careful with that. But I'm guessing with plumbing and such, probably the most infected area would be like the toilet seat flush would be the area where I would be, you know, extremely cautious about if you're concerned. But again, the virus does not stay that healthy that long on those areas. So in the case of where you're touching areas where you'd be highly prevalent or people that could be infected touch, like doorknobs, toilet flushers, that sort of thing, make sure you wash your hand after you touch it. And again, not touching your face or your eyes. I can't speak on testing and when testing supplies will be back around. I don't know. At this point, my feeling on testing is, yes, it is scary. There is a problem. We don't have enough tests. But the vast majority of people, over 80%, will have this virus and have a mild to moderate infection, where even if we did test, it would just more or less confirm what you had. We're using symptomatology, meaning how badly you are feeling and whether you have changes in your vital signs or changes in how you're breathing or how much oxygen you're getting in as a severity of the disease marker itself. So if you did not have those, we would expect you to probably get better without any issues within the next, you know, 10 to 14 days, those people with over 80% improving without any treatment or anything. And so in the test itself would only confirm that you had the infection. And we are talking about doing self-quarantining anyway, meaning if you are feeling not well, stay at home, limit yourself and exposure to other people.
Thank you.
Thank you. Our next question is from Jennifer about the stay-at-home order. Jennifer, what's your question?
Hi. So I realize, I think I understand, of course, about the curve, and I also understand that, you know, we're going to see higher numbers as more people are tested and things like that. My concern comes in with, obviously, we can't monitor what everybody's doing in their personal settings. I think the theory of jobs that are necessities becomes, in some respects, opinion, because everybody's job is important to them. So if we don't see the kind of numbers changes that we're hoping due to people really not quarantining them, I shouldn't say quarantine, staying home and staying secluded as they should, what is the potential next step? I mean, what are we hoping to see, or how will we move forward with this if people are not abiding by this, as we have seen in some certain circumstances, people having house parties and things like that?
I'll answer that one. The stay-at-home order is until April the 7th, and that they're asking people to use common sense and stay at home. It's somewhat loose in where people need to get out. I think everybody understands that. Are we heading towards a situation of martial law and you know, going to arrest folks that are out in the street? I don't think so. But again, if people use common sense and they stay in their homes unless it's for necessity type things, I think that over the course of time, we'll get to the point of where that curve has flattened out and it's, this is a much more manageable situation. But the way that things are spiking today, we need people to stay at home. That's the most important thing.
Okay, we have about 7 to 10.
David, you know what? Real quick, there's a question from Rodney about his wife has to go to court in Maywood. We believe that it's only for emergency motions that the court is open, so we can answer Rodney's question real quick, and then let's go on.
Rodney, you're live.
Hi. The first, I'd like to say I think it's a great service that the representative is offering to the public, and I just wanted to know if the Maywood courts were postponed or what.
Rodney, we believe that it's for emergency motions only. I believe that the court system is pretty much shut down, and I think that they'll grant you some immunity if you don't show up, being an elderly folk that may not want to get out into the world and go down to a court for whatever that situation is. So I think you're okay staying home, and if you need any other assistance, please feel free to call the office. Okay, David.
Elaine has a question about the jail system, and Elaine, you are live now.
Yes, I was just wondering, for those workers who are working within the jail system, there aren't a lot of protocols that they are working with right now. As a matter of fact, for the employees, there aren't any protocols. And so then they come home, and they come home to their families. What is the protocol once they come home? What should we be doing to try and protect everyone within the household?
Dr. Allegretti, would you touch on that one?
Sure. The main thing that I would recommend as it relates to employees in, you know, high-risk settings, a prison, possibly a nursing home, obviously anyone working in a hospital or healthcare setting, one of the things we stress to our docs and our nurses here, one thing we may consider beyond just hand hygiene and making sure you've cleaned up post-shift is not wearing the clothes that you are wearing at your job home. If there's a way for you to change, either in a locker room or prior to entering the home, that may be a way of limiting the chance of bringing in some of those respiratory droplets I had talked about that could still be on your clothes and limit exposure to your family. The other thing is, you know, if the person who's, you know, in the environment that's more high risk can have a dedicated bathroom in the home, that could be helpful in limiting the chance of contact spread. The high risk areas in any home are the kitchen and bathroom. They're just the areas where things get touched the most. So whatever you can do to limit that, and the more you can wipe down those areas, will go a long way in helping to prevent spread within a home if, unfortunately, you know, your significant other or family member actually has COVID and is just not aware of it or starts to have those symptoms.
Thank you.
Our next caller is Bonnie. Bonnie is asking about concerns about testing hospital workers. Bonnie, you should be live.
Okay, let's go on, David, if Bonnie doesn't seem like she's still there.
Next question is from Carol, and Carol's just got concerns about carry-out foods and delivery.
Yes, Carol? Yes, good morning. Hi. My question is concerning carry-out foods. I'm just wondering what precautions the workers themselves take. Are they wearing gloves? Are they wearing masks? Because how do we know if they're coughing or sneezing on our food and we think we're safe and we don't know? What can you tell us anything about that?
Carol, I think that's a good question, that when you place your order that you should ask the establishment just so you feel comfortable with continuing through with your order. I know a lot of the restaurants are having these no-contact deliveries, so you pay with a credit card and they leave it at your front door and they ring the bell so you know it's out there. And I think that that's going to be a personal decision on how you feel with the place that you're placing your order with.
We have another online question that came through, and it's from Michelle. And she's wondering just what can she do to help? What can the normal, everyday person do to help during this crisis?
I think that it's to stay home and to encourage others to stay home as well, volunteer with local organizations to be able you know, to deliver meals to those that that you know may need that. There's also a website, serve.illinois.gov, that you can go and volunteer your time as well. Thank you.
Roxana is on the line, and Roxana has a question about how long it takes to develop immunity and what the future is when this comes together more. Roxana.
Hi, good morning. I have one medical question, one administrative, so to speak. The first is, if one is exhibiting, let's say, mild, moderate infection symptoms and is, you know, 10 to 14 days have passed, do you develop an immunity to it? That's my first question. The second is, you know, as we're practicing social distancing and sheltering in place here in Illinois, almost dovetailing on Jennifer's question, when we have when the schools come back into sessions, there's kids that are down in Florida on spring break right now. And, you know, they're not going to be coming back until Sunday. So, you know, we've been social distancing for a week. Now we have no school. How do we deal with all of those kids who are just going to be coming back while we've been doing it for 2 weeks?
Doctors?
This is Dr. Elgar. I can answer the question. Oh, I'm sorry. Answer
no,
questions
ahead,
that relates to immunity. We do not know if you develop lifelong immunity to the COVID virus. The COVID virus is changing, meaning it does mutate, which is not uncommon for any type of virus. And so there can be changes in how the virus appears. And while you may develop immunity to the specific strain that you were exposed to, whether that confers lifelong immunity, we just don't know yet. So time will tell, but I think it's too early for us to give you a definitive answer as it relates to that.
And there's no real way to build your immunity to fight this because there are such unknowns still regarding this, correct?
Yeah, the most important thing is for you to try to keep yourself as healthy as possible. That gives you your best chance to, you know, beat any virus, whether it's influenza, you know, COVID, just the common cold, whatever we're exposed to, the better health you can maintain, good diet, sleep, exercise, that goes a long way to help you, you know, beat any of these viruses.
I think the other thing that this social distancing will do when we talk about flattening the curve is hopefully give the healthcare system time to develop either a vaccine that's effective in treating this or develop some sort of treatment protocol that decreases symptoms. And so although we're not going to necessarily decrease the number of cases where people get exposed and have infection, we will decrease the amount of surge we have and hopefully make it so it's more manageable over time as we develop perhaps a vaccine or treatment. And that's the one thing that I think people are rushing to do right now, and they're doing testing for that. But we're probably a good couple months out from anything, if not longer, before some of that comes out.
Okay. Thank you.
We've had over 150 questions submitted, so I apologize if we weren't able to get your question. We do have one more from Robert, who is asking about how many cases we have had so far. Robert, you're on the line.
Hi. I was wondering if you can give me a guesstimate of the confirmed number of cases in our area.
Doctors, can you do that from each of your locations?
I would say that there's a large number of people that have come in that we have suspected have had it. I think the numbers are only continuing to rise. Representative Stevens had said what the current number is, but I think that's a very significant underestimation is what's out there. People have talked about, you know, travel and, you know, their exposure, but I think the disease is now here. And so utilizing those sort of parameters as whether or not you traveled as a potential exposure, the thing is in the community, all we can do is what we're doing right now with self-isolation, good hand hygiene, and trying to protect ourselves from getting it from somebody that's in the community itself. I think the numbers will only continue to rise in the next couple of days, and hopefully as we have this, you know, social distancing, we'll see a drop or flatten the curve within the next week is my hope. But I think the numbers I've seen at the hospital and the number of people that have had symptoms consistent with COVID has just exponentially risen in the last week and a half.
For anyone whose question we did not get to, there will be an opportunity at the end to leave a voicemail message for us. So please stay on the line, and in 5 minutes you'll be able to leave a voicemail, and we will be working diligently to get you those answers to those questions in the next day.
Okay. Thank you, David. And again, any of the online questions, we'll get to those as well. There's a very good likelihood that we'll be having follow-up tele-town halls to be able to continue to answer the questions as this virus evolves and as we get more and more information. Like I said, we're getting information daily from the governor's office. That trickles down from the federal government as well. So a lot of that stuff is on the website. I want to thank Dr. Allegretti and Dr. Jordan and ask them if they have any final thoughts that they'd like to make here before we let them get back to the grind. Dr. Allegretti?
Sure, thank you. You know, both my team and Dr. Jordan's team, the hospital systems that we're part of, you know, I don't want to say it's been our singular focus, but our major focus has been preparedness as it relates to dealing with COVID illness. And, you know, all of our healthcare systems have done as much as we can to ramp up our services to ensure that we're best prepared for this. But there's only so much in healthcare that we can do. And the truth of the matter is, the more social distancing we perform, the more we follow the shelter in place mandate by the governor, that's going to do more to protect our community and actually protect us all in the healthcare system. There's a slogan going around. I didn't come up with this, so I don't want to take credit for it, but I think it really summarizes kind of our thought process, is that we protect you by coming to work. You protect us by staying home. So if there's anything I really would like to stress here is that social distancing, this shelter in place, while I know it's difficult for all of you, it really is going to help us in the long run, and it's going to help us beat this. So whatever you can do to continue to do that, encourage others to do it, it will help. And the more we do it, the better chance we have of beating this.
Thank you, Dr. Allegretti. Dr. Jordan, would you like to make any final statements?
I further echo what he said. I think the social distancing is going to be the key to our success in our ability to manage this in an appropriate manner. Like I said before, the number of cases that we're seeing where they're truly sick has continued to ramp up, and I think only will ramp up if we do not follow that. And so although I don't like being at home alone and not spending time out in the public, I think it's a necessary evil that will protect us and protect the general healthcare system as we are continuing to see more and more cases out there.
Okay, thank you both for spending the time here today. We'll look for further guidance down the road. All of the medical professionals that serve with you are true heroes for what they'd face on a day-to-day basis, along with our first responders. So we thank you for your service. And again, stay healthy, and I know you're going to stay on top of this thing. So thank you again, doctors. I owe you a steak at Gibson's. So
our
also,
pleasure.
Alana,
thank you.
Okay, thank you. Make a final plea. Anybody that may want to volunteer their time, there's many of family and neighbors that are still struggling that may need some help, whether just being checked in on or with some help going and picking up a prescription or groceries, whatnot. So that's at serveillinois.gov. serveillinois.gov. If we didn't get to your question, please hang on the line another minute, and once the call ends, you'll have an opportunity to leave a voice message at the end of the call. My office will be able to reach out to answer those questions. Or if you're more comfortable just calling the office, again, the number is 773-444-0611. or you can email me at Rep Stevens, that's REPSTEPHENS, at ILHOUSEGOP.org. And again, the phone number 773-444-0611. You can also sign up for email alerts at repstevens.com, and you can learn about future town hall meetings that we'll be holding this way. Again, thank you for participating, and we'll all get through this together. Have a great day.